Greetings. This video addresses the second point raised by Muslim poster, the Jedi. Also, you keep saying Satan tempted Jesus. Why are you not saying that Satan tempted God? This is what makes me sick about Christians and Christianity. They speak in riddles, trying to make a lie become the truth. The concept of the temptation of Messiah is something Muslims do not understand, brother. In fact, Islam does not want you to understand. You ask, why do I not say Satan tempted God? The reality is that the temptation was directed specifically at Jesus. And while Jesus walked as a man, Jesus had laid aside his deity and taken the form of a servant. Philippians 2:7, but emptied himself, taking the form of a bondservant and being made in the likeness of men. While Jesus walked the earth, he was not fully endowed as God with divine glory and infinite knowledge and infinite power. The whole reason that the temptation occurred was for Satan to attempt to identify if this was the Son of God finally come to the earth, as the prophets had foretold. As we discussed in part one, the reason Satan asked, if you are, is because Satan knew God had a son. So the issue with the temptation was for Satan to try and identify the Son of God. Let's look again at your post, brother. Also, you keep saying Satan tempted Jesus. Why are you not saying that Satan tempted God? There is another aspect that you are overlooking, and it goes back to your first question answered in part one. Satan knew God had a son, and Satan also knew something else about God. God cannot be tempted into committing sins. James 1:13, let no one say when he is tempted, I am being tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, and he himself tempts no one. God cannot be tempted into committing sins. Also notice it says, God himself tempts no one. I won't go into the implications of that in this video. Again, Islam's wrong definitions and lack of desire for scholarly thought causes confusion for Muslims. Like so many words, tempted has multiple meanings depending on the context. Definition 1. To entice or attempt to entice someone to do or acquire something that they find attractive but know to be wrong. We see in this definition two entities involved, the someone who is tempted and the one doing the tempting. Definition 2. To have an urge or inclination to do something. In this definition, there is only one entity, the one who has the urge. So if Satan tempted Jesus, how many parties are there to this interaction? The answer is two, Satan and Jesus. Definition one deals with two parties. So that means we need to apply definition one for us to properly understand this interaction. But that does not mean that definition two was not involved. To have an urge or inclination to do something. In fact, it is because of the second definition that Satan implemented the first definition. We know God cannot be tempted into committing sin, tempted by another. That's definition one. Let no one say when he is tempted, I am being tempted by God. See, that's two people right there. I being tempted by God. Now, in parallel, for God cannot be tempted with evil. Tempted by who? Someone else. So that's definition one. And that is because God does not have the urge. Definition 2. And that is absolutely the key point of this topic. God does not have the urge. Definition 2. Satan's test and temptation of Jesus is to see if Jesus has the urge. The test is one piece of evidence that proves Jesus is God, but before all the evidence is examined, it is premature to call Jesus God. Answering your point, brother, that is one reason I say Satan tempted Jesus, but I do not say Satan tempted God. If Jesus has the urge to sin, Jesus is not, cannot be, God. If Jesus does not have the urge to sin, Jesus is God. That is the core purpose of the temptation. So, Muslims considering a jihad based on this topic misapply the definitions of tempted to suit their jihad. Their interpretation runs along the meaning that no offer may even be made to God. They can't even consider definition one. Sadly, that is an error which sends the jihadi into a ditch, leading to their destruction. Satan had to offer the opportunity to Jesus to see if Jesus had the urge to sin. Think about this with me, brother. How does tempting Jesus determine whether Jesus is the Son of God? God cannot be tempted with evil. God cannot be enticed by offer of opportunity to commit evil. That is because there is no urge or inclination to do something evil within God. Satan offered the opportunities to Jesus to see if Jesus had an urge or inclination to do something evil. If Jesus had an urge or inclination to do something evil, it would prove Jesus is not God. So Jesus proved he did not have an urge to do something evil because Jesus resisted the tempting offers Satan made. This proved Jesus was the Son of God come in the flesh, as the prophets had foretold and Satan had expected. This is what makes me sick about Christians and Christianity. They speak in riddles, trying to make a lie become the truth. The rest of your post, brother, sounds like frustrated venting, because you cannot understand the gospel as it has been explained to you before. That may have been because the explanations were incorrect, incomplete, and not proven from the scriptures. However, it may also have been because you have tried to use wrong definitions that Islam has given you. Just as in part one I explained that God is a spirit, for this topic you must understand what the word tempted means. I have shown both definitions and how to properly apply them. An honest Christian answer should be based on the Word of God and logical application of definitions. However, not every answer by a Christian is informed by scriptural knowledge or by respect for God's Word. There are as many reasons for that as there are for the many divisions in Islam, even though they claim to read one Quran. But there is one other element that we must honestly consider, brother. God is higher than our imagination. The plans and thoughts of God are literally a mystery to the mind of man, and even the mind of spirits like Satan. Colossians 4:3, as you pray also for us, that God may open to us a door for the word, so that we may proclaim the mystery of Christ, for which I am in chains. The true knowledge of the Messiah, or Christ, was a mystery. Romans 16:25. Now to him who is able to strengthen you by my gospel and by the proclamation of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery concealed for ages past. The mystery of the plan of God was concealed for ages past. Ephesians 3:2, surely you have heard about the stewardship of God's grace that was given to me for you. That is, the mystery made known to me by revelation, as I have already written briefly. The mystery of the gospel was made known to Paul directly by Jesus. Galatians 1:12, I did not receive it from any man, nor was I taught it. Rather, I received it by revelation from Jesus Christ. In reading this, then, you will be able to understand my insight into the mystery of Christ, which was not made known to men in other generations, as it has now been revealed by the Spirit to God's holy apostles and prophets. The mystery was revealed by God's Holy Spirit, the Comforter, that Jesus promised to send. He said this in John 16:12, I have many more things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. But when He, the Spirit of truth, comes, He will guide you into all the truth, for He will not speak of His own initiative, but whatever He hears He will speak, and He will disclose to you what is to come. This is the Comforter Jesus promised in John 14 and John 16, the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of truth, who would reveal the mystery of the gospel, among other things, which was not made known to men in other generations, as it has now been revealed by the Spirit to God's holy apostles and prophets. This mystery is that through the gospel the Gentiles are fellow heirs, fellow members of the body, and fellow partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus. It was, and is still, a mystery to the Jews that Christians are now partakers in God's covenant with Abraham. It is a mystery to Muslims who think they join the covenant by circumcision of their flesh. The gospel must be understood by knowing the message of the prophets, and Islam denies that knowledge to Muslims. The message of the prophets is there for you to read, if you have respect for Abraham, for Moses, for Jesus, and for God who sent them. But understand, brother, the gospel is God's plan, and makes no sense to our selfish thinking. This is not Christians trying to make a lie into the truth. The truth makes sense, and may be examined and questioned and handled. It is Islam, brother, that commands you to not ask questions. Surah 5:101. O you who believe, ask not questions about things which, if made plain to you, may cause you trouble. The trouble Muhammad warned of is seeing the contradictions and leaving his religion because of it. But Yahweh God makes no such prohibition of questions. Psalm 51:6, behold, you, and this is speaking of God, you desire truth in the innermost being, and in the hidden part you will make me know wisdom. God desires truth in our innermost being. James 1:5, if any of you lacks wisdom, he should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to him. Proverbs 2:6, for the Lord gives wisdom, from his mouth come knowledge and understanding. Matthew 7:7, ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and the door will be opened to you. This is what makes me sick about Christians and Christianity. They speak in riddles, trying to make a lie become the truth. Unfortunately, brother, you simply cannot bear the truth, because you do not have the Comforter Jesus promised to believers. But if you pray to God, the God of Abraham, ask Him, the God of Abraham, to open your eyes so that you may see and understand the truth. I will even pray with you for that for you, brother. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.